Yeah, we're still good. We're still good.
Okay, this one?
Yeah.
I'm going to use the microphone because I have a soft voice. I want to make sure that you hear me. First of all, thank you for Shane and Chris for having me out here. And I have some handouts that I made in the back here on the clinic, so please take one. And if for some reason we run out and you don't get one, come see me after and give me your email, and I'll email you a copy. And I want to thank my endorsement companies also, Remolded Perth, Sabian, for allowing me to have this opportunity to share my story with you guys. And before I get into the Badaz, I want to give you a brief little history about myself, and especially in regards to the Badaz. I was born in La Habana, Cuba, and I was raised in LA, and I recently relocated to the East Coast. And so again, thank you for allowing me this opportunity. And with the Badaz was actually one of the first percussion instruments that I saw and I fell in love with before the bongo and everything about it. I started on kit, but the Badaz was actually what started me in percussion. And at first I wasn't encouraged because I was told that women are not supposed to play Badaz. And then also I had a few colleagues that were telling me that I should only concentrate on congas and timbales because that's the primary instrument that I would be playing with as far as contemporary music, to just focus on congas and timbales. And I didn't listen to them because my heart just really loved the Badaz. And I didn't have a specific reason to want to play them. I just wanted to play them and learn about them. And I went back home to Cuba, and I had wonderful teachers. And actually, I had the opposite experience. The master teachers that are teaching women now, they felt that it was their responsibility to pass on the knowledge. So when they sat with me and we had private lessons, they felt that they had to teach me because there's so much information within the Afro-Cuban music and percussion that one of our masters die, some of that knowledge goes with them. So they felt that they have to pass on that knowledge as much as they can because a lot of it is lost anyways. And when one of them die, a little bit goes with them. So it was actually the opposite. They loved teaching me, and they passed on lots of wonderful information. So the Badaz, they're originally from Nigeria, from the Yoruba tradition, and they're originally sacred ceremonial drums that were played in the temples of the Yoruba tradition. And during the slave trade, when the different African traditions were coming into Cuba, Puerto Rico and Dominican Republic and all the Caribbean, they brought the customs, the language of the Badaz, of the drums, the dance, the different rhythms, and they were kept in Cuba in these secret temples called cabildos. And in the 30s, a Cuban historian named Fernando Ortiz, he went into the cabildos and he started documenting all the different rhythms and history of the Badaz and how they came about from the Yoruba and the master Badaz players. So he wrote lots of books. His name's Fernando Ortiz. And in 1930, he wrote that he wanted the Badaz to come out of the temples because they're so pretty, the melodies and the rhythms, that he wanted people to hear them worldwide. So in 1936, he made that happen. He had a public performance in Cuba, La Habana, and he brought the Badaz out of the temples, and they were performed live in front of public for the first time. And after that, 40s, 50s, they started playing Badaz in orchestra music, symphonic orchestras. And then the 70s was when Iraquere, Chucho Valdez and Iraquere, he started incorporating Afro-Cuban folklore music with the Badaz and also Shekere and other African traditions as well with the jazz. And that's also the period of Dizzy Gillespie and Chano Bosso. And Dizzy Gillespie also wanting to know about the folklore of Afro-Cuban music and going to Cuba and studying. So all that was going on in the 70s. And then in the 80s, Joel Driz, the percussionist of Tropicana, he was one of the first guys to perform the three batas together. And that's a modern approach. Late 80s, 90s, then you're getting into now the 2000s, Bimba music and all the modern bands using the batas and jazz, Herbie Hancock, Bill Summers, you know, Climax, also Patacumbele. I want to definitely say Patacumbele in Puerto Rico was with the Iraqueta era in the 70s, also having batas in there. So the batas started becoming a lot more popular, a lot more common, but it's all recent. And now in the last like 10 years, I would say that now the approach of playing the three batas all together is a modern way. So at first, originally, you have three different players. You have one person on the iya, you have another person on the itotele, which is the second drum, and a third person on the baby drum, the okonkolo. And traditionally, you start playing bata, you go up in your education. You start out with the okonkolo, the baby drum, and traditionally, some guys would stay on the okonkolo sometimes for years before they graduate to the itotele. And then the itotele, and when you move on to the iya, then that's when you're becoming a master in the batas. And the person playing the iya is the one that's in charge of the language. It's a language that you're learning when you're playing bata. It's not an improvised instrument. It's something that you have to learn. It's like learning a language. So you have to start out with the baby and move up. So playing the three, again, is something that's a modern approach to playing the bata. When you're first learning, I highly, highly recommend that you start out the way you're supposed to. You start out with the okonkolo and move up so you can understand the language of the bata. So I'm going to play. One story I want to give you really quick as far as playing the batas too is that, you know, follow your heart with what you want to learn, because I had a wonderful experience with my teachers, and Regino Jimenez is one of my teachers that is the one that told me that he had to teach me, because it was his responsibility. And in 2006, I had the opportunity to do a percussion performance in Montreal Drum Festival, and they told me I could do it on anything. And I chose the batas, and it was the first time I was gonna do a drum solo, and I took the batas to every gig I could so I could practice and do the batas solo performance before in Canada. And I just wanna share that because if I hadn't stuck to my heart and that opportunity came, I wouldn't have been able to do it. So, and since then, I have recorded batas not only on my album, but on other people's albums. I just got asked last week to lay down some bata tracks in LA. I've done bata clinics. I've done bata performances with my band, with other bands. There's lots of things that you can do with the bata instruments. And especially now, it's becoming a lot more popular. And so I'm going to do the batas solo now, so you can hear a little bit of that. Okay. what Bob does is you can hear has got a lot of changes going on. And again, they're not improvised instruments. So it's like a prayer, a composition that you're learning. And in the composition, you've got changes going on. And what the difference is with the badaz, in the sense of when you're playing the three, when you're playing with two other players, the person in charge on the iyad, you can play badaz worldwide, and you can go anywhere around the world. And if you run into people who have also been schooled in the badaz tradition, you can sit with them and you could play these instruments. What makes the difference is the iyah, the player, their feel might be a little different, or when they're going through the changes, you might stay there in a longer period of time or shorter period of time. It all depends on the person sitting at the iyah. So again, when you're playing the itotele or the ogonkolo, you have to be constantly listening to the iyah player. You can't just sit down and play whatever you want. You know what I mean? You have to. So it really develops your ear a lot. This is great, not just for the percussionist and for the drummer, but musicians in general, and getting into Afro-Cuban music. Chucho Valdez, Gonzalo Rubalcaba, again, Herbie Hancock. All these musicians study the roots of Afro-Cuban music, which comes from the folklore. So it comes from the badaz, it comes from other African traditions as well, the gongo, the arara, the abacoa. There's a lot of African traditions that were maintained in the Caribbean, and that's the roots of Afro-Cuban music. So you can hear that there's a lot of changes going on. I'm gonna play one more rhythm for you that just demonstrates that, the different changes that goes on in one rhythm. Thank you.
also the Bata language and knowledge, and you could use them for solo ideas and congas. And also, the more knowledge you know about African music and percussion too, not only incorporating the Bata language, but like the gongos and the Arawa, and the more you know, the more you have to give and express. And also, you can also recognize that in also other players as well too, and you can appreciate what they're doing. And you're listening to, oh, he put, you know, Wigui, a rhythm from Bata Wigui in his solo, and you're like, oh, that's cool, you know? So it's a language, a universal language that you can understand. So I'm gonna do a conga solo, and I'm gonna incorporate some Bata stuff in there. And I did do it on my first solo that I did at the top. But now that you've heard a little bit of Bata during this last 30 minutes, I'm sure you'll be able to hear it more now.
Feel to be one of the few women that are actually playing percussion instrument.